And not many days after, the younger son, gathering all together, went abroad into a distant country, and there wasted his inheritance, living riotously. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Now, we have certainly all come across at some point over the years a picture, a painting, an image, a holy card of the prodigal son. The moment with which the father receives this young delinquent back into his embrace. We arrive at the middle of Lent on this fourth Sunday. We have miracles before the weeks before. On this fourth Sunday, we have conversion. And then we have miracles following after, and then of course Palm Sunday and the week of our Lord's Passion. We come to the middle on the question of conversion because it's precisely what Lent is supposed to be doing. To be able to come to a knowledge and the ability to change how we have lived up until a present moment. It may be in large things, it may be in small things. And it requires intelligence, and it requires memory. Conversion requires intelligence because it requires us to be able to see. It requires memory because we have to have an idea of where we are supposed to be, who we are. Now, this gospel is very beautiful. And this chapter 15 of St. Luke, in its context, it's proper for us to understand, even more so this week, to understand the context. This parable is proper only to the Gospel of St. Luke. None of the other three evangelists record this parable. The first part of this chapter 15, of course, begins with the beautiful part of the parable of the Good Shepherd. Who has 100 sheep, one wanders away, he leaves the 99 and goes out to find. And this, the other Gospels also record. St. Luke also gives us the episode of the woman who has 10 coins, basically worth about 20 bucks each. And she loses one of her coins and totally dumps her house upside down, throwing around the furniture to find this one coin. And when she finds it, she's thrilled. Her house is a mess, but she's thrilled because she found her 20 bucks. And in this gospel, we have this proportionality then in this chapter. We go 1 in 100, 1 in 10 that's lost, and to 1 of 2 that is lost. What our Lord is doing in this gospel is showing the compassion and the patience, the waiting of God for us to come to our intelligences, and our memory as the children of God to return. Because chapter 14 and chapter 16 are actually quite severe. In the teachings, and I would encourage you this weekend, and even during this week, go back over it during the week as part of your prayers. Chapter 14 and chapter 16, what our Lord is emphasizing is our personal freedom. What is in the parable here is the goodness of God waiting for us. Chapter 14 and chapter 16 are on our personal responsibility that grace is offered to us, that love is shown to us. Love always requires reciprocation. You can't have someone love someone who ignores them. Love is always reciprocal, or else it just simply isn't love. And so what our Lord is emphasizing in chapter 14 and chapter 16 is that personal freedom to be engaged with the divine grace and the love that God has shown us. So for example, in chapter 14, we have the call to the banquet. And the people who are busy with other stuff, I've got a new farm, I can't come, please excuse me. And of course, the king in charge of the banquet for his son is furious. He says they're not worthy of the invitation. And then he goes and has the servants drive all of the homeless and the beggars out of the streets, fill the banquet up with them then. And it's in this gospel after that parable where our Lord Lord says that he who will not take up his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. We must follow after our Lord. And even more severely in chapter 14, he says, he who does not hate father, mother, brother, sister for my sake is not worthy of me. Meaning that the one who does not make me the very center of their existence is not worthy to enter into redemption. This is very severe. But what our Lord is doing is emphasizing that we are free and that we have to make choices when we are brought face to face with the love of God and the work of redemption. Salvation does not happen by magic. It's not because Jesus died on the cross that we're all going to heaven. It's by Jesus dying on the cross and rising from the dead that we all have the potential to enter into the kingdom. But it's a potential. It's an invitation. And what our Lord is emphasizing in these two chapters, 14 and 16, because immediately after this parable today, is going to go on to the parable of the unjust steward. The man who is devious and squanders his master's goods. In which at the end of it, our Lord says that the children of this world are wiser than the children of light. They get it. They know how to pay the mortgage. They know how to make their business advance. They know how to find affluence. They know how to move up in the world. The children of this world are wiser in their affairs and their business than are the children of light. Meaning, the children of light don't seem to have a clue when it comes to salvation and entering into the path of the gospel. These are hard because they're emphasizing that we are always free. And since we are always free until the day we die, there is always the possibility that we will ignore the invitation and turn away. St. Francis de Sales said that famously, the last temptation in our lives will take place 15 minutes after we are in the grave. In other words, it's always going to be a possibility that each one of us have the possibility of being distracted by our new farm. To wander off to some other thing. And our Lord says, this makes you unworthy of redemption of the gospel. Which is why these parables in the center are so important, because he's saying, but you must remember, God is always waiting. God is always not only waiting for us, he's watching. The Father, as moved by compassion, runs out to meet this young man, his delinquent boy, before he even gets to the house. And what we also see in the very first verse of this chapter 15, which is beautiful, is even as severe as these teachings are in chapter 14 and chapter 16, we are told in verse 1 of this chapter, before these parables, that the sinners and the publicans, the public sinners, flocked to hear what our Lord had to say more. And it's to them, he told them, that God is waiting. And thence we have these parables. Now what we notice about this young man in the parable today is that he is self-centered, to say the least. This parable can be read at three different levels. The first as an allegory of the conversion and the relationship between Israel and the Gentiles, between Israel and the non-Israelites. The Gentiles, of course, being the younger son, and Israel being the older son. And that's the way many of the scribes who would have been present in the crowd would have understood it. But there is also the way of just simply an analysis of sin, of the selfishness that is at the core of every sin that you and I commit. I'll make up my own mind what is right and what is wrong. That's the sin from Adam and Eve that echoes all the way down to this day. The essence of original sin is not about an apple or a tree. That's not what it's about. It's about humanity saying, I will decide for me, myself, what is good and what is bad. And if I don't want to go to Mass on Sunday because I'm playing football, well then, good for me, and who cares about God? I have decided that that is the better thing for me now. And that is the essence of sin. I am the one who arbitrate, not God, not beauty, not virtue. I decide. And that is what this young man does. So put yourself back in 1927, in Head of Falls. But we use our terms still of Situ and Jiddu. But of course, we often translate it as grandfather and grandmother, but it's not grandfather and grandmother. It's Arabic for patriarch, matriarch. Not just grandpa, it's not Pepe. It's the patriarch from whom our family originates. And so when this young man goes to his dad, so we put this in the Middle Eastern context that our Lord is giving this parable. He is walking up to the patriarch of this family and saying, listen, old man, you ain't dead yet. I want my stuff now. We don't want to wait for this will to be read. Give it to me now. Now, not only is it offensive to your father to say, you know, you're taking too long here, but it is also the patriarch, the one from whom our whole family originates, the notion of the veneration and the esteem and the respect, which is to be paid to him, not just simply of love and affection, of course, but within the context of a veneration. The people would have gasped when he would have begun this story, because everyone would have been completely horrified by the way the story was being told, that he should do this. And then the parable goes on to say, and a few days later, he gets his gear together and he just takes off. So not only is he not helping with the farm, he just takes whatever he got in his inheritance and leaves, and doesn't just simply leave, he goes to a distant country. He goes far away. Some place where he can be anonymous, live the way he wants, and decide for himself what is good and what is bad. And of course, the parable develops from there. The third way that we can read this parable is simply about stewardship. How we ourselves individually use and deal with and invest in the stuff that God gives us during the short time that we have on earth. We all come naked and squealing into the world with nothing. And we're all going to leave, well, not completely naked. Someone will dress our corpse, hopefully. But we leave with nothing. Someone buys a box. Maybe we buy the box ahead of time. And the third way of reading this parable is, what do we do during the shortness of this time of stewardship of the things that God commits to our care, but which never really belong to us because we can't take them? And so we have stewardship, which is why chapter 16 begins with the parable of the unjust steward. So those are the three ways this parable can be read. But as we mentioned, conversion is about intelligence and memory. It requires intelligence to see where we are wounded, where we need to be healed, where we have to change. So recently I was listening to an interview of a woman who had written a book about her cancer. But she came down with colon cancer at the age of 35. She was going to die. Now this struck home, the interview, because I think I mentioned to you, I once buried a woman who died of breast cancer at the age of 37. It was quite dramatic for the parish at the time. But she kept going in because she was bent over in pain. And the doctor kept looking at other things. She's 35, kept looking at other things wrong. Until she said that literally she was in his office screaming at him that you must do other tests. And he found at that time not only that she had colon cancer, but that the tumor had already metastasized and was already spreading throughout her 35-year-old young body. And she had a 2-year-old son. She was devastated. When we look at all of that, of course, it's the moment that she finally knew what was wrong with her. Now at 40, she's still alive. The surgery was done, treatment was done. It seemed to have at least under control, but she's always in pain. The reason why I bring it up is because conversion also requires intelligence. Under the care of that doctor in the beginning, she would have simply died because he was not using his smarts to figure out what was going on. He overlooked it. But regardless of overlooking it by accident or by incompetence, she still would have died. And conversion requires intelligence because it requires us to see what is wrong. And regardless of whether it's malicious or out of stupidity or just simply distractions, we will still die if we don't convert. It will still kill us. Sin will still be our death. And the memory, because the memory is what we are meant to be. What the gospel has taught us over the years, what it means to be virtuous and to be the children of God. Which is why in verse 17, as this young man goes, whooping it up with the girls in town, living the high life with his father's money that his father had spent his adult life bringing together so this kid can totally waste it in the period of a few years, we're told that famine comes. And this kid can't deal with it now because he has no resources. And as he has to go out and hire himself out to someone in the middle of this distant country, stuck out here now, he can't even if he wanted to travel back home, he can't because he doesn't have any money. So he hires himself out, and the person that he's employing him sends him out to the farm to take care of the pigs. Now again, there would have been this gasp in the crowd that would have been listening to this parable. Because pigs are not only physically dirty, they eat everything. They're unclean ceremonially. They make you polluted. You can't eat them. Pigs serve no purpose for the Israelites under the law of Moses. The pigs were something which were unclean, and that you're feeding them to keep them alive and sustain them was considered an absolute horrible enslavement and subjection to something which is despicable. And here he is, slopping pigs, looking at the slop. I don't know if you ever had pigs around or ever had farms. They eat everything. When I used to teach at the seminary, we had a farm. I used to go out because we'd have the seminaries on occasion clean out stalls. It's always good to keep your feet on level ground as you do philosophy. But we used to have feral cats, of course, around the farm. But you could count them, because on occasion, the little kitties would get too close to the slop troughs. And the pig was just as indifferent of eating slop and eating the cat that was on the rim of the slop trough. So every once in a while, the number of kitties would just kind of go down. And you knew that one of these poor farm cats had just been sucked into one of these voracious pigs that we had. We ate them, though. But at the time, of course, not the cats, the pigs. The people listening to this, the idea of how low this young man had arrived, a feeding pigs, is precisely in verse 17, we're told, and returning to himself, he said to himself, I'm going to get up, I'm going to rise and go back to my father. Because he has a memory. We have two things going on here. One is he returns to himself. He begins to integrate the way he thinks and the way he feels, and not just simply thinking by his stomach and his loins. And he began to return to himself and become a whole man again. And he said, I have to get up from this and I have to go back to my father. I have violated and sinned against heaven, and I have sinned against my father. But what initiates this is his memory. As he looks at the slop, thinking, I could eat this because I'm really starving and no one's giving me anything really, he thinks the servants in my father's household. He's not thinking about his life, his bedroom, the television, the iPad, the computer he has in his room, all the nice things that his father used to buy for him. He's not thinking about his life because he knows that he has destroyed his life So what he thinks about in the parable of the servants, and these slaves, and these employees, these hired hands, they have more than enough to eat. And I'm here slopping pigs and starving to death because, not because of anyone else in the world, in the 21st century, everyone else is at fault except me. It's the government. It's the page, it's LePage, it's whoever it is, you're killing our children. These articles in the paper have been ridiculous recently. You think LePage was going around rampaging in the country, got killed, the state killing all the children. Amazing. Anyway, we do this where we don't accept responsibility. This boy does not think about his personal life. He thinks about the goodness of his father who takes care of his own. And that's why, returning to himself, he thinks of the servants who at least have enough to eat, more than enough to eat, he says. I have to go back. And I have offended God, I have sinned against heaven, and I have offended my Father. And he goes back. And this is the essence of the parable then, at the point that God is waiting, and God is anticipating the return, God is moving us by his grace, and God is the one who goes out and runs in compassion to this delinquent boy. But notice what takes place in the parable. There are three things that this young man says when he finally remembers intelligently and comes back to himself. I have sinned against heaven and my Father. I am not worthy to be called a son. And I ask that I only that he accept me as a servant, as the third thing. And when he returns and he's walking on the road all disheveled and dirty and probably emaciated from his food and the famine, and his father throws his arms around him. A lot of times it's translated as embrace, but it literally means he falls on his son's neck. The young man can get out. I have sinned against heaven and against you, Father. Check. Very true. But it doesn't stop the love of the Father. I am not worthy to be called your son. Check. Also very true. There's a question of justice here. But the compassion of the Father is that before the boy can say, so receive me back as a servant, let me just stay under the staircase and live here and work. That part, he doesn't even allow the boy to say. He allows him to confess his sin. He allows him to confess his unworthiness. And then he says, bring the robe, bring the ring, bring the shoes for the boy, and that fattened calf that we've been saving for Christmas, slaughter it. We're having the party now. That is what takes place. And when the older son comes and he hears the party going on, he's working in the field, and they're whooping it up with the delinquent brother of mine who's ruined all of his money and wasted it on prostitutes. Everything that the older son says is true. It is justice. I have worked here for years. I have done everything you've asked me to do. And you haven't even given me a goat, some dumb little thing, to have some small party with my friends. Never. And this, your son, he doesn't even call him his brother, your son comes back and you give him the best of everything. Are you nuts, old man? But the parable is teaching us not that justice doesn't count. The father allows him to say, I have sinned, I have sinned, I have sinned, and I am not worthy to be your child. He allows him to say it because it is true. And what the older son also says is true, but it's justice. And the old man, we are told, pleads with his son to come in. And he says, you are here, you are with me, you've always been with me. And everything I still have is yours. Please come in. Because your brother, he reminds him in justice, he is your brother, not just my son. Come in. Because your brother who was dead has returned to life, and he was was lost and he hasn't been found. So thanking you for your patience on this extraordinarily long sermon. May all the angels of heaven and the saints intercede for us at this middle of the great fast to obtain for us the grace of illumination of our mind, that we also may have intelligence and memory to know where we are supposed to be at this present moment in our lives, and intelligence to diagnose what we need to heal, where we need to convert, what we need to do, and to give us the strength to return to the Father, whose love is always waiting, so that we ourselves can be restored and healed and brought further beyond justice into the divine love, which is the whole purpose of the gospel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen.